Jackie said that the choir got y'all going for me, so now it's my job to keep you going, I guess. But if anybody's feeling like you might start nodding off, Cooper's got about 10 pounds of sugar down here, and he'd probably be willing to share with you if you need something to keep you awake a little while. Thank you, choir. Man, I love hearing those children sing, too. They did a fantastic job. I appreciate those who work with them, and I love listening to them sing. If you got your Bibles today, I want to go ahead and ask you to open up to the book of Acts. We'll see that up on the screen in just a minute, but I'll go ahead and tell you that's where we're going to be, the book of Acts, chapter 2. Acts, chapter 2. Last week, we began looking at this, this thought that the church is an embassy. The church is an embassy. We said that our God is a God who wants people to know Him. Our God is a God who wants people to have a relationship with Him. Our God is a God who wants people to have an accurate representation of who He is so that people can know the God of this world. And so Jesus' end goal, really, when He came to this earth, was the kingdom of heaven. Christ came to rescue people from their sins, to gather to Himself worshipers who would worship Him forever and ever and ever in His presence. Now, that day hasn't come yet. God is building His kingdom as we speak. God is building His kingdom. He is gathering worshipers for Himself from all over this globe, all over this planet. He is calling people to follow Christ and become worshipers of Himself. And so how is He doing that? Well, when Jesus was here, Jesus on this earth was an accurate representation of God. In fact, He was the very God Himself. God came to earth. Christ was God in human form. And so there was a beautiful, perfect representation of God right here on this earth. And Jesus, while He was on this earth, He authorized certain people to be His representatives once He left. We know those folks as the apostles, the disciples. And last week, we looked at a very important passage of Scripture where the disciples, Peter probably speaking on behalf of all the disciples, made an incredibly important confession about who Jesus is. And Peter said, "Jesus, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Excuse me. And then Jesus responds to Peter and says, "You're right." I'm kind of paraphrasing. He says, "You're right, and You didn't come up with this on Your own. In fact, the Father in heaven, God, revealed this to You. That's how You're right. That's how you can believe the right thing about Me, because God has placed that in your heart. And on you, having made this confession, I will build My church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and what you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and what you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." It's an incredible statement about the foundation of the church. Jesus began the church. If you ever wonder where the church come from, where this idea of church come from, well, it came from Jesus Himself. He said, "I will build My church." And He built it, He began building it on true confessors of Him. That is, people who believe the right thing about Jesus, who believe that He was the Christ, the Son of the living God. That is the church that Jesus founded. And since that time, He has continued to build His church here on this earth. And that church is to always be made up of people who are true confessors. Now, in that passage that we looked at last week, we saw that Jesus gave an incredibly important responsibility to the church. In His absence, it is the church's responsibility to authorize ambassadors for His kingdom. The church is an embassy here on this earth representing the kingdom of God. And the church has been given the responsibility and the privilege of authorizing ambassadors. Now, we said last week that doesn't mean that the church saves people. It doesn't mean that. Unfortunately, some people have got that wrong throughout history, and there are churches that, and I use the word church loosely, that believe that they actually save people. That's not what Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, I'm the one that's going to rescue people from their sins, but I'm going to give the church, I'm going to give you as believers the authority to examine someone's life and say, yes, you have trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. You can be a representative with us of God's kingdom. Now, that's a mouthful, but that was last Sunday's sermon, and as quick as I can kind of summarize it. And it's important for us to remember that because as we talk this week about becoming an ambassador, we want to keep it in the context of what the church is. The church is an embassy of God. And if the church is God's embassy here on this earth, then we need to make sure that the people who are calling themselves representatives of King Jesus are actually people who are representing King Jesus well. Does that make sense? If the church's mission, if the church's responsibility from Jesus himself is to look at somebody and say, yes, welcome into our fellowship. You come on in. You are going to represent Jesus along with us. Question is, who do we give that that right, that authority to be a representative of Jesus to? Do we just hand those badges out to anyone that we want to? Or do we need to be careful in who we say, yes, you are a representative of Jesus to? I think it will be the latter. I think that we would want to be careful in that. So this morning, what I want us to think about and talk about is, how do you become an ambassador? How do you become a representative of King Jesus? What are the steps that are necessary to have you could say, a badge placed on you and say, hey, I get to represent Jesus in this world along with the other representatives of Jesus called the church? I think the best place to go is to the first church. That first church began in the city of Jerusalem. And so this morning in our passage in the Acts, we're going to see how that very first church admitted members into its fellowship, placed that stamp of approval on them, and said, you are the representatives of King Jesus here on this earth. That passage is found in Acts chapter 2, verse 37 through 42. I'll give you just a little bit of background on that passage. Jesus has died. He's resurrected from the grave. He's ascended back to the Father. And in light of that, his followers have gathered together, and Jesus told them that on a certain day, the Holy Spirit will be poured out on you. You'll be my witnesses, beginning in Jerusalem, and then all the way around the globe. Well, here we have, in Acts chapter 2, Jesus pouring out his Spirit on his followers, on the apostles, and Peter stands up and preaches a sermon. Now, gathered in Jerusalem at this day and time, at this particular time, were Jews from all over the nations. They gathered for this festival called Pentecost. And so Jesus is preaching to a bunch of Jews, but they are Jews who speak lots of different languages. And many of you know the story. As the apostles are filled with the Holy Spirit and they stand up to preach, all these people who speak different languages hear them speak in their own language. It was a miracle that God worked in these apostles. And so all of these Jews out here are hearing the gospel preached. We find that Peter's sermon beginning around verse 14 of chapter 2, going all the way through verse 36. That sermon. And then what we're going to look at today is the response. As these Jews hear that Jesus is the Messiah, that he came, that they crucified him, but he resurrected, and through his death and resurrection, he has provided a way of salvation, what then do they do in response? And that's where we pick up in Acts chapter 2, verse 37 and following. Let's read this, and you follow along as I read. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brothers, what shall we do? And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, save yourselves from this crooked generation. So those who received his word were baptized, and they were added that day about 3,000 souls. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. Heavenly Father, as we look at this passage of Scripture today, as we talk about becoming an ambassador in your kingdom, Father, I pray that you would open up our hearts. God, teach us. Maybe teach us something that we didn't know before. Reaffirm something in our hearts that we have known. God, call us to take a step of obedience. today. But God, we pray that whatever you call us to do through your word, that we would be obedient. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How do you become an ambassador? I hope and pray that you desire to represent Jesus on this earth. If you're a follower of Christ, that's what you've been called to do, to be an ambassador, to help other people have their relationship with God fixed. That's what it means to be an ambassador of Christ. The Apostle Paul said that God is making his appeal to people. What is that appeal? That appeal is to come and be reconciled to the Father. God is making that through us. So I hope that that is a desire that you have to represent Jesus here on this earth. Well, how do we become an ambassador? The first thing we see in this passage is we must respond to the gospel with personal saving faith. We must respond to the gospel with personal saving faith. What does that mean? What does it mean to have personal saving faith? Notice in verse 37. After Peter preaches the gospel, it says that the people, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were cut to the heart. What does that mean to be cut to the heart? It means that they realized that they were sinners. See, the first step of personal saving faith is to realize who we are apart from Jesus. Apart from Jesus, we are sinners. Peter was very clear and said, "You crucified Jesus. You crucified him." And for the very first time, they realized what they had done. I wonder if there's been a time in your life where you have looked at your life in light of who God is and realized what you have done. There was a time in my life where that took place, where I, for the first time, saw what those children this morning were singing about, the holiness of God, that he is perfect. And then I saw my life in light of that holiness and perfection and realized that I wasn't like that. There was sin in my life, and that sin had separated me from a holy God. And in that moment, for the first time in my life, I was cut to the heart by the gospel of Jesus Christ, the realization that I was a sinner. I was broken over my sin. That's the first part of responding to the gospel with personal saving faith, means being broken over our sin. See, we don't just jump to believing right things about Jesus. Oh, yeah, I believe that Jesus died on the cross. That means I'm saved. I have a place in heaven. But if I was never broken over my sin, then I don't really understand the magnitude of Jesus coming and dying on the cross. The first step of personal saving faith is being broken over our sin. Joel chapter 2, verse 12 through 13, the Lord says this, "Yet even now return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning, and rend your hearts and not your garments." Come to the Lord with mourning, like with sorrow in your heart over your sin. But here's the good news. That passage in Joel goes on and says, "Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster." When we come before God broken over our sin, his response to that is to turn from the disaster that we deserve. That is to have his wrath poured out on us because of our sin. But he requires for us to come with brokenness over our sin in our hearts. Psalm chapter 51, verse 17 says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." I wonder today if you've ever been broken over the sin that's in your life. But having personal saving faith in the Lord doesn't just end with brokenness over sin. We don't just feel very guilty about our sin before God. That just in and of itself doesn't save us. It starts there, but then we must repent of our sin. Look at verse 38. After they say, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter says, "Repent." Repent. What does that word repent mean? It simply means to turn. Say, "This is who I was. I am turning from that sin." You see, it's one thing to be broken over our sin, but it's another thing to want to change directions. Just being broken over our sin, but saying, "Well, I'm broken over it, but I'm sorry that I did it, but I'm going to keep on doing it." Well, that's not true saving faith. So to be broken over our sin, then that leading to repenting of our sin, and then I would say the next and final step, trusting in Christ as your Lord and Savior. Belief in Jesus. Brokenness over sin, repentance of sin, and belief in Jesus. Verse 38, he says, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And if you skip down to verse 41, he says, so those who received his word. What's it mean that they received his word? They received the gospel of Jesus because that's what Peter had just preached to them. They received that. They welcomed that gospel truth in their life. They were cut to the heart. They were broken over their sin. They repented of their sin. They said, that's not who we want to be. And then they trusted Christ as their Lord and Savior. They were repented and baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. You see, it's one thing to be broken over your sin. It's one thing to want to change. But how do you have the power to do that? It's through the transformation that comes through the blood of Jesus Christ, rescuing you from your sin. I wonder today if you've been broken over your sin. I wonder today if there's been a time in your life where you have repented of your sin. I wonder today if there's been a time when you have trusted in Christ, believed the gospel, believed that he came and died on the cross to rescue you from your sin, that he rose up from the dead, defeating sin and Satan and death, securing for you eternal life, providing forgiveness of your sin. When we think about becoming an ambassador or a representative of Jesus Christ, this is the first step. It's to have personal saving faith. Not trusting in someone else's faith, but you, me, as an individual, believing that I'm a sinner and trusting that what Jesus did on the cross was enough to rescue me from my sin, that it was enough to reconcile me back into a right relationship with the Father. You see, if someone doesn't understand that, and if someone hasn't believed that, and someone hasn't been transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ, then how in the world could they be a true representative of Jesus in this world? They couldn't. Now, oftentimes there are false representatives, people who claim to have trusted in Christ, but we can look at their lives and know that there's no change. They're not following after Jesus. Who are true confessors, those whose lives have been radically transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's evident because if you look there in verse 38, he says at the end, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. You see what the Holy Spirit does? He comes into our hearts and into our lives and begins to transform who we are on a daily basis. If you've trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior, if you've taken this first step of becoming an ambassador by placing your faith in Jesus Christ, then your life looks different today than it did before you took that step of trusting in Christ as your Lord and Savior. If your life doesn't look any different, then you need to take some time to think about whether or not you really trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. Because it's not a question of whether or not you might receive the Holy Spirit if you trust in Jesus. Peter says, you will receive the Holy Spirit. And what's the Holy Spirit do in our lives? He makes us look like Jesus. That's the Holy Spirit's role. The Holy Spirit's role in our lives is to point us to Christ. And as he points us to Christ, we are pointing others to Christ. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit. That I'm looking more and more like Jesus on a daily basis, and I'm calling others to saving faith in Christ as well. So it's evident that someone has had personal saving faith. But what about after you have personal saving faith? What's the next step? Well, Peter's very clear. The next step is to respond to the gospel with a public profession of faith. So it starts with a personal saving faith, and then it's a public profession of faith. What is this public profession of faith? It's very clear here in this passage that it's baptism. And Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Baptism is the public profession of faith given in Scripture. Jesus himself commanded us to be baptized. I want to go back to the foundation. Why do we practice baptism? Why does Peter command them all? Every one of you who trust in Christ need to be baptized. Well, it's because the Lord Jesus commanded that to happen. Before Christ ascended back to the glory of his Father in heaven, He said, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. That involves preaching the gospel so that people can get saved. Make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I've commanded you, and I'm with you always to the end of the age. It's very clear Christ commanded his representatives to preach the gospel, and then when someone trusts in Christ, to baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Also, Jesus himself was baptized. Baptism publicly identifies us with Jesus. Not only are we being obedient to Jesus' command, but it's a way of us publicly identifying ourselves with Christ. Jesus himself was baptized. It's an incredible story, an incredible thing to think about, that Christ was baptized. We'll save that for another day. We could talk for a while about that, why Christ was baptized and what does that mean. But when we are baptized as an expression of our faith in Christ, we're following in our Savior's footsteps. We're identifying publicly with the one who has rescued us from our sin. Not only does it identify us with Jesus, here's what baptism also does. It publicly identifies us with Jesus' representatives. It publicly identifies us with the people who are currently following Jesus. So I trust in Christ as my Lord and Savior, and then I publicly identify myself with my Savior and with his people. And that is through the act of baptism. I wonder today, maybe you've trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe that's a decision that you have made. You've repented of your sins, you've been broken over your sin, and you've confessed Christ as Savior of your life. But maybe you've never followed that up with believer's baptism. Maybe that's a step that you need to take. It wasn't just for some of them. He said every one of you needs to repent and be baptized. And then, once they had repented of their sins, they had trusted Christ, they were baptized, then, here's what's incredible, immediately they were added to the number. They were added to the number. Look at verse 41. So those who received his word were baptized. So those who received his word, that means were saved, were baptized. Baptism always comes after you're saved. And there were added that day about 3,000 souls. We could stop for a while and just think about that. That's a big number all at one time, 3,000 souls. But what were they added to? What were they added to? Well, certainly they're added to the kingdom of God, but they weren't just added to the heavenly kingdom of God. They were added to his earthly embassy, which is called the church. How do we know that? Look at verse 42. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. So the third step is to respond to the gospel with devotion to the community of faith. Respond to the gospel with devotion to the community of faith. That community of faith we call the church, the local church. Immediately, they repented of their sins, they're baptized, and they were added to the embassy. They became representatives of King Jesus. Notice what they did. They were devoted. They devoted themselves to what? They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. That means they have devoted themselves to learning God's word together, growing together. They devoted themselves to the fellowship. That means they devoted themselves to sharing gospel life together. Not just showing up, hearing the word preached by the apostles, and then going about their daily routines without any other interaction with fellow representatives of the kingdom. To fellowship together in this passage in the Bible, to fellowship together means that as fellow representatives, as fellow ambassadors, we, in a sense, live our lives together. Like, we share our lives together. We encourage one another. We share burdens with one another. We pick one another up. We sharpen one another. We help one another grow. I look at you and I say, here's a way that you can do an even better job as a representative of Jesus. And you look at me and you say, here's a job that you can do, an even better job as a representative of Jesus. And so we live life together as followers of Christ, as his ambassadors. So they're taught the word together, they fellowship together, the breaking of bread together. Now, this probably refers to meals. They probably spend a lot of time eating together, but There's also a little bit more specific thing that this is referring to, probably referring to the Lord's Supper. As they had meals together as representatives of Jesus, as followers of Christ, they would have partaken in the Lord's Supper. Now, we're going to talk about that a little bit more next week. But they were constantly together remembering the gospel of Jesus. That's what the Lord's Supper is about. Remembering the sacrifice that Christ made on our behalf. They didn't do that individually. They did that together. And they were devoted to it. And then the final thing they were devoted to is they were devoted to the prayers. They were devoted to praying together. We see later on in this passage that one of the things that they were devoted to doing was praying. I said in this passage a little bit later on in Acts, they were devoted to pray for boldness to speak the gospel. That's what they prayed for. They prayed for boldness to speak the gospel. What is that? What's that mean? They were praying for boldness to be his representatives in this world. They were saying, God, our mission is to represent you well. Would you give us the boldness to do that? As your ambassadors, empower us, encourage us, give us the strength and the courage and the boldness to go out into our world and together be a shining light of the gospel of Jesus Christ, representing him well to a lost world. This is the first church, the very first church, the church at Jerusalem, was begun. What were the steps? Saving faith in Christ, public profession of faith through baptism, and then a commitment to the local congregation. They committed themselves, they devoted themselves to one another. What does that mean for us? Well, let's think about our church. I want us to look at this in two different lights as we think about how this applies to our lives. First thing I want us to think about is as a church. What does this mean for us? I said last week that we want to be a church that does the very best job we possibly can of representing Jesus well in this world. Because that's what he's called us to do. And I think the best way to do something God has called us to do is to do it God's way. The best way to do something God has called us to do is to do things God's way. Not to try to do what God wants us to do on our own terms, but to do things that God wants us to do God's way. He's called us to represent him well. He called the church to do that. So what does it mean then for us as a church to put into practice this passage of Scripture? Well, I think number one, the church, as we think about authorizing someone to be his representative, that means accepting someone into fellowship at our church, that is accepting someone in to be a member of our church, the church should carefully examine a person's confession of faith before receiving him or her as a member. What's the first step? Is to have a personal saving faith in Jesus Christ. And so a clear application of that is we shouldn't let someone be a member who hasn't trusted in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I mean, that's just a clear application from this passage of Scripture. The first step of becoming an ambassador is to have trust in Christ, your Lord and Savior. And so someone says, hey, I want to join your church. First thing we need to know is, well, have you trusted Jesus? Have you been rescued from your sin? Because that's the most important part of being a representative of Christ. This takes some time. It shouldn't be rushed. That's one of the reasons that when I first started here, I think the very first Sunday I was here, I mentioned this. That if you're interested in joining the church, what I want you to do, and it's still true today, if you're interested in joining the church, come after the service and say, hey, Zach, I'm interested in joining, and we'll set up a time for us to talk. You know what we talk about when we talk about you joining the church? We talk about if you trusted in Christ or not. That's one of the main things. I want to hear your testimony. I want to hear how Jesus has rescued you from your sin. And that's just being obedient to the practice of the early church. But then, what's the second step is baptism. The church should view baptism as a requirement for membership. Why? Because that's how the early church did it. Because we're being obedient to Jesus' command. I mean, if someone refuses baptism, then the church should view that person's profession of faith, personal profession of faith, as not credible because that person is not willing to be obedient to Jesus. Or maybe they just need a little bit of time to understand that that's the next step. But regardless, we don't want people saying, I'm a representative of Jesus, but I don't want to be obedient to Jesus. Makes sense to me that God would want people to represent him who are going to be obedient to him, obedient to the teaching of his word. But then, what was that next step? They eagerly devoted themselves to one another. And so the church first looks for saving faith in the person's life and then says, all right, have you followed that up with baptism? And then the church says, are you ready? Are you eager to be devoted to the community of faith? Are you ready to be an active part of our fellowship? Not just do you want your name on a roll. Not just you want to kind of say, yeah, I'm a church member, but I'm not actually going to be a part, an active part. No, because the early church members, they were added that day to the fellowship and they devoted themselves to sharing life together. And so the church should look for an eagerness to become an active part of its fellowship from those desiring membership. Three simple steps that God very clearly gives us in his word for how the church should authorize someone to be an ambassador. What does it mean to become an ambassador? Trusted in Christ as your Lord and Savior, baptized with believer's baptism, and an eagerness to be devoted to the community of faith. Now, that's application for our church as a whole. But what about you as an individual? Perhaps today you're here and you realize you've never trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. Maybe you've been visiting and you say, I want to be a part of this fellowship. I can tell that there's some good stuff going on here and people's lives are taking the form of Christ and there's joy in their hearts and I want to be a part of that. The first step for you, if you've never trusted in Christ, hear me clearly, you need to believe in Christ as your Lord and Savior. And the offer for forgiveness of your sins that Peter made to these thousands of folks gathered in the city of Jerusalem, that offer is still there for you today. Maybe today you need to repent of your sins, be broken over the sin in your life, and then trust in Christ to forgive you based on what he's done on the cross. Maybe that's a step that you need to take. I encourage you, if that's you, don't leave here today without having trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior. There's no other way to be saved. But maybe you've done that. Maybe you've done that, and next thing for you is to be baptized. Maybe you haven't followed that up with believer's baptism. I encourage you to take that next step. Maybe after the service you come to me and you say, hey, Zach, I've trusted Christ as my Lord and Savior, but I've never been baptized and I want to be baptized. That's awesome. Maybe you're not sure about it. You say, I still don't quite understand why we do that or what that means. Hey, come talk to me and we'll talk about what that means and why we baptize the way we do and that kind of thing. But that's the next step, to be baptized. Or maybe today, you've trusted Christ your Lord and Savior, and you've been baptized, but you don't belong to a community of faith. Maybe today you need to come to me after the service and say, Zach, I want to talk about joining Southside Baptist Church. You know, I've trusted Christ, I've been baptized, but I don't belong to a church family. Today, maybe that's the step that you need to take. Or perhaps, you've trusted Christ, you've been baptized, and you belong to our church. You're a member here. But that devotion thing, devoting themselves to the teaching, the fellowship, the breaking of the bread, and prayers, maybe that's not really true in your life. And today, you just need to ask the Lord for forgiveness and say, God, I've trusted in Christ. I've been baptized, and I'm actually even a member of the church, but I haven't really devoted myself to being an active part of the life of the church. So maybe today you need to recommit your life to the church, recommit to what God has called you to do and being an active representative of him together with his embassy called the church. There's so many different ways that maybe God is speaking into your heart and life with this passage of Scripture. This isn't the only place in Scripture where we see these things taking place in the early church, but it is the first place. And I think it's the place that we ought to go as we say, how do we as a church authorize ambassadors for the kingdom? It's a huge responsibility, and we want to do it the right way. It's also a place for me to go as an individual, say, how should I be authorized? It's a place for you to go as an individual and say, how am I authorized as a representative of King Jesus? God has called us to be a part of something so great. The local church, the embassy of Christ here in this world. Let's make sure that we're obedient to the teaching of Scripture. Whatever God is calling you today, I want you to be obedient to that. Maybe you have questions about it. Come ask me, all right? Come ask me about those after the service. I'd be glad to talk with you. The most important thing is for us to obey the Lord, whatever He calls us to do. Let's pray. Almighty God, we love You, and we thank You for Your Word. Father, Your Word encourages us. It lifts us up. It also challenges us. God, it instructs us in how we're to live our lives. It also instructs us in how the church is to function. God, You have given us an incredible gift in the church. God, it's Your idea. Jesus began the church, and He is continuing to build the church on true confessors, on people who have trusted Christ as their Lord and Savior, and are seeking to live their lives in accordance with Your Scripture, with Your Word. But Father, You have given the church an incredible responsibility in that. Father, our desire is that we would hold the keys to the kingdom well. Father, that we would admit into fellowship only those who You would admit into fellowship. God, we want to be obedient to You. Father, maybe today there's someone who needs to trust in Christ as their Lord and Savior. They've never received forgiveness of their sin, and today they are burdened by the weight, the guilt of their sin. Father, I pray that they would leave that at the cross. Father, that they would repent, and they would turn to Christ. Father, maybe today there's someone who needs to be obedient by saying, yes, it's time for me to be baptized. Maybe there's someone who needs to be obedient to You by saying, it's time for me to join a church. Father, maybe there's someone today who says, it's time for me to step up. It's time for me to be an active part of this local congregation to which I belong. Father, maybe there's some things as a church that we need to do to be obedient. God, whatever You're calling us to do, Father, our prayer is that You would soften our hearts. Our prayer is that You would take away pride, that would keep us from being obedient, that we would humble ourselves before You and say, Father, Your way is the only way, and I'm going to be obedient. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.